The red. The red was pearl and crimson.
What did you tell your subjects you were doing?
So beautiful.
Skin super. separate to that. But it, I think it is an intriguing thing to consider when you do, like, linguistically, how we speak oftentimes, it's the pain of a broken heart. There is aspects, I think, of that emotional experience that when it's really extreme, ultimately, it's calling in our protective systems. It's engaging those protective systems of our body, of which one of those is pain. So I do think that pain as an experience itself encompasses all of those different inputs, but that when we think of very strong emotion in the absence of any other injury or anything going on, that that can elicit some of these protective responses in our body.
Given the way you're describing the many factors that contribute towards pain, particularly chronic pain, I wonder how helpful is medication?
Yeah, I think it, for some people, medication plays a helpful role, particularly in the early stages of helping to engage and re-engage, I guess, with different activity in life. But I think the challenge that we have is that many times medication is seen as the very first course of what should be done. And particularly in chronic conditions, there in the past was a tendency to go to things like opioids. And the problem that we have with that now is that when we look into the literature behind this, use of opioids actually can increase the sensitivity of someone's system, meaning that as you continue to take opioids, you have to first of all take more to get the same effect, but actually you end up maxing out and it's increasing your pain by making your system more sensitive. So I think there's real limitations with medications.
As you described it, it is such a fine line between acknowledging the pain that's real, but perhaps questioning where the real source of that pain is in order to be able to better treat it. What attitude do you recommend that people bring to their experience of pain?
An attitude of openness and of listening and of curiosity to understand processes that are going on. I think generally as humans, it's really hard for us to think beyond this idea of cause and effect. This happens, therefore I feel this one thing, this one cause and this one output. And it's really, I think, being open to exploring the fact that for every single person, including me, including you, all of our experiences of complex things like pain are ultimately influenced by numerous different things. And that resonates deeply in someone's gut. When that, I do think that that's what is occurring, that can be really helpful because it also can then help make sense why we're starting to look into other areas.
Rings and impression.
What small changes could we make here that actually might help? And when all of those things build up together, it's like the bilby in the bath, but for good. There's that tipping point where things start to get better.
Have you seen that with patients, with people you've worked with?
Yeah, we have. So we've run some studies with people with osteoarthritis, and some of the changes that we've seen with that have really been remarkable. So
one is cerulean blue.
Other contributing factors? Am I feeling, you know, any anxiety around random different things in life? What do I really deeply think is going on in that hip or that foot? And I sort of take stock of that and say, is it reasonable that today, given me, given my environment, given what's going on, that I could be feeling more pain, but I haven't actually injured myself? And almost 100% of the time, it's yes. And typically then, what I'll do
they soon learned that the nicest time to go for a walk on the beach was midnight. Especially if there was a full moon, that meant there were no other animals. There were no dogs to chase the cats or the chickens or the rabbits. And they loved it. It was one of the most beautiful things I've ever done in my life, because the cats would run ahead, and they would hide, and they would ambush the dogs, and the rabbit would be hopping along, and even the chickens would come. You know, I had no experience before that with chickens, and I suddenly realized, they're wonderful. They have personalities. They have desires. They were, at first, by the way, I let the chickens work with me in my study where I was writing the book. They would perch sometimes on my shoulder, and they would watch me type. They were actually fascinated. But my wife objected because you cannot, or at least it's very difficult, to house train a chicken. I'm sure it's possible. They're smart enough to know. I think they care that much.
I think it's the cats that I'm most curious about on this walk, Jeff. They really went along with this, did they? Willingly.
Looks like we're seeing about the labels gone.
Yeah, I think part of the reason, first of all, the cat in that book, which I finally published, there's a picture, it's my favorite picture, our cat. And one of the cats, we have many, one of the cats and the big rabbit slept together at night. And the cat would literally put his arms around the rabbit and they would sleep. And I couldn't believe it, so I took a picture of it. And it was really true, they got on so well. Now, and part of the reason they got on so well with the dog is the dog grew up with them, so he never, ever chased cats. I mean, for him, cats were like dogs. They were family members. And the cats understood that. But cats being cats, one of them decided, really hurt my feelings. One of them, Mickey, decided he wanted to move next door. And he did.
Maybe he needed some peace and quiet, Jeff. Maybe he needed a break from all those other animals.
You know, I had thought of that. You're probably right. But he suddenly started jumping up on the chest of the man next door who was asleep, who did not like cats. And this man would throw him out. And this went on for 2 weeks. Finally, the man said, I give up. He's mine. And then he stayed there for years. And then one day he decided he wanted to move somewhere else. And I wonder, I haven't heard this from other people who live with cats, but I wonder if that's common, because it seems to me that cats are slightly more, I mean, they can be very attached to us, of course, but they also seem to me to be more attached to places. Dogs don't care where they are, as long as they're with you. But cats kind of like to know, this is home, this is where I live, I know it well. But this cat was peculiar, and he just changed homes.
What about that Dutch giant rabbit? What ended up happening with him?
Well, we adored him, but we realized that we lived on a public beach, and he could not understand why he should only go out at night. So he started hopping around on the beach during the day, and then he would hop back home. But I realized that was a dangerous situation, because dogs didn't understand who he was. And he was chased a number of times, and I was terrified that one day he would get hurt by a dog. So we had some friends who lived way up north, and they fell in love with the rabbit. They said, look, let us have the rabbit. He is totally safe here. So we did. We drove up there, gave him the rabbit, and the rabbit was in heaven, because he lived right at the edge of a huge forest. And it was like a guest house. People would come and stay there. And the rabbit would greet them. He would sit on the deck and he would wait for people. Then he'd hop over. And every night he would go off into the forest. So during the day, he lived there on the porch. And at night he would go into the forest. And they said one night he did not come back. And they suspect that he found another rabbit and decided to make his life as a wild rabbit food for us.
I mean, that's the optimistic understanding of the end of that rabbit. I very much hope that it was the case. But, you know, that sort of points to the theme, I suppose, of this new book of yours, Jeff, is that once we enter into living with an animal, there's only two possible endpoints, aren't there? Either we die first or that animal dies first. I mean, heartbreak is built into our relationship with pets.
Absolutely. And You know, it's almost as you say that, as you were saying, and I was thinking about Hufflepuffle, as we called him. We called him Hufflepuffle. But it was scary to think that when they go off on their own like that, they might not come back. And of course, I do believe that something must have happened, because he had a lovely life with these people, and then he did not come back. And it's very difficult to face that all of these animals are going to die before we die. But we had pet rats for our two boys growing up, and they adored these rats, and I knew they were only going to live between 2 and 3 years because they were bred like that. It's a terrible thing to realize. And they're very affectionate rats. I was surprised at how affectionate. But it was a tremendous blow to the children when these animals would die. They took it very seriously. And when they were very young and they still didn't really know what the concept of death was, they couldn't quite understand why are they no longer here. And in a sense, that's true of even adults. You know, why aren't you here? I sometimes think about my father. I would love to tell you things now. I have lots to tell you.
Is that one of the benefits, in a way, for children in particular, perhaps, to have a pet? It is an introduction to mortality. It is an introduction into this reality that living beings die, and we too will die. Is that part of the sort of deep lesson that we get from animals?
Well, thank you, Sarah. That's a really interesting idea. I had not myself thought of it. So had I talked to you before, that's a very good point. Yes, I think you're absolutely right. I mean, you can't spare people from this. And there is something wonderful about children loving another creature and then losing that creature, because they're not indifferent when the animal goes. They feel it profoundly. And that's important, because that teaches them about grief and mourning and kind of, if you like, almost the upside of that, how it releases feelings in them that they might not otherwise have access to. And there are many adults who cannot grieve and cannot mourn. And I would wager that they did not have those early experiences as a child, which loosens up those emotions inside of them.
What about your own experience, Jeff? Or what was your first experience of the death of a pet?
I can remember that I was very, very attached to a cat. And this cat was taken very early from its mother, so it thought of me as the mother, and it would sleep with me at night. And by the way, one of the great pleasures of life is sleeping with a cat. They're amazing companions at night. You know, they stretch their little bodies out, they begin to purr, and that sense that they trust you to be next to them at night, not And it's a huge book. It would be, in translation, something like 20 volumes. Very simple Sanskrit, very lovely to read. And with this pundit one day, I said, I'd like to read something inspiring. And he said, I have the right thing for you. And it was the dog story. And what it is the great king Yudhishthira is moving north, which in mythological terms means he's coming to the end of his life. He's going to go to the Himalaya. seven, eight of us, and there's a big, large oak dining table. And he said, suppose I were to raise this table and make it dance in the air. Would that convince you? And I thought for a minute, you know, this guy crazy. And I said, well, yeah, if you make this table jump into the air and dance around, that would be something I would reconsider. And so he made us all close our eyes, and then he placed his hands on the table. Everybody had to put their hand on the table, close their eyes, and then he starts chanting what he claimed was Sanskrit, but which I knew was not. And then it's very important that you keep your eyes closed. So of course I opened my eyes, and what I saw was this tiny little man. He was under 5 feet tall, very, very small. He took his little hands, he started pushing the table, but he said, I feel it. The spirits have come, the table is moving. And at that moment, and I will forever regret it, I said, I'm not surprised the table is moving because you're shaking it with your teeny little head.
Why do you regret saying that? This seems a perfectly reasonable thing to say.
Of course, but imagine what would he have done? See, if I had only shut up, I would have seen, I suppose he would have said, no, the spirits, they don't like the atmosphere today or something. But I would have been curious to know that everybody was very embarrassed. And my father even said to me, Jeffrey, that was rude. And he was right. It was. I didn't need to humiliate the guru in that way.
What about your parents, Jeff? When the guru's prophecies of the Third World War didn't eventuate, and did they become skeptical?
Well, they got a little bit skeptical when he didn't show up. So we were waiting for him in South America. And we never knew where he went until one day I was giving a talk in, of all places, Auckland, New Zealand. And I mentioned his name, and somebody said, oh, yeah, I know him. He lived down the street from me. I said, what? It turned out that PBU went to New Zealand. We never knew. He then moved to Switzerland, and he died in Switzerland. I think he was about 82. But not, and after that, I then told my father that I wanted to write about this, and I wrote a book called My Father's Guru, A Journey Through Spirituality and Disillusion. And I think that also disillusioned my parents to some extent, because, I mean, it was a friendly book, but it was definitely an attempt to expose the guru and other gurus. It was an anti-cult book. And the people who had followed Paul Rudd would never talk to my parents again.
You say that when you sort of woke up to yourself and realized you were teaching Sanskrit at a university and this wasn't you and wasn't what you wanted to be doing with your life, what did you do next?
Well, I made another mistake. I decided I wanted to become a psychoanalyst. So for the next 10 years in Toronto, I was trained as a psychoanalyst. I went through the full training, which means you have to be in analysis yourself 5 times a week.
like our own gang. We almost didn't need any other friends to hang out with because there were the three of us. And what we always loved about three, even when you had a fight with one, there was another sister you could play with. So there was always variety. So you were never on your own. And we did naughty things together. You know, at the time it didn't seem that naughty, but I think it was a combination of the freedom and then the confidence that freedom gives you that, yeah, we can climb that tree, we'll be fine. And then, of course, someone ends up falling out or breaking an arm or doing something crazy, and then we, you know, create another drama about how we can pretend that's not how it happened so we don't get in so much trouble. So we were always coming up with stories and adventures, and we all loved, you know, Edith Blyton and the Famous Five, and we sometimes would pretend, you know, that we were on those adventures, you know, making sort of heather beds and drinking lashings of ginger beer. So it really was an adventurous childhood, particularly in Tasmania, and then later on when we went back to Africa as well. Yeah, we had a lot of fun.
How important was cricket to your family, Indira?
My father would often joke that we would only live in countries that followed cricket. And we absolutely did. We were all born in South Africa, then we moved to Zambia, and then, of course, we have Indian heritage, so cricket is very, they're very passionate about that as well. Then we moved to England, of course, where cricket started, and then came to Australia. So cricket really was the soundtrack of our lives. Early in the morning when you'd wake up, you'd hear the sound of, you know, the leather on willow, one of the commentators' voices that we got to know, you know, from Tony Grave to the ABC commentators. That was just what was always humming in the background in our house. And going and seeing live matches was the highlight of us.
Inspired by Tony Grave, what game did you used to play in the backyard?
One of the things Tony Grave used to do was his pitch report. Before every game, he would crouch on the pitch and poke his pen or his key into a crack in the pitch to give you a sense of whether it was going to be a good pitch for the bowlers or the batting side. And we used to just love that moment where he's picked
the drama.
I know, the drama, and the camera would go in for a close-up of the crack, and then he'd pull out the key and there'd maybe be a bit of grass or dirt on it. And then what we would do during the lunch break or the tea break is we'd grab one of Mum's set of house keys and we'd run around the backyard plunging a key into the garden. I don't know why that was so funny, but that was what we did. And yeah, it was inspired by Tony Grave.
One glorious summer, the West Indies team came to Launceston. Who took you to the match?
No one took us. So we never got really taken many places. We just went on our own. I mean, you just walked down the road, you walked into, you know, wherever we needed to go. That was just life growing up in country Tasmania. But yeah, we had some tickets, and we got up early in the morning. We prepared our picnic basket and our thermos and our autograph book to make sure that we could, you know, try to get the autograph of one of the players. And we just headed to the cricket just on our own, and we were just so used to doing that. And we had some members' tickets because Dad was very passionate about that. And that was also, I'm sure, quite a funny sight. These three little dark-skinned Indian girls sitting with largely older white men in the members' stand, but very serious. You know, all our girlfriends were out, you know, shopping or watching it, you know, going at the cinema or something, but we were there with our thermos and our transistors, you know, giving all these sort of detailed conversations and remarks about their batting performance and how the bowling was going. I don't know what they thought of us, but that particular day we were at the West Indies cricket team, which were the rock star god cricket team in the 1970s, were doing a very unusual cricket tournament in Launceston, and often, you know, the big teams didn't come to Tasmania, so we were so excited, and we couldn't wait to get the autograph books. My younger sister Monica, while there was a break in play, ran down to the fence line where the fielders would often stand and give the little kids their autographs to try to get one. And we sort of lost track of her, my other sister and I, and we were watching the game, and then a bit later on we wondered where Monica was. And when I looked down near the fence, instead of her at the fence waiting for a cricketer, she was surrounded by this throng of kids, and I'm thinking, what's going on? And this young little kid came running out of this little scrum and said, Mum, Dad, I've got this amazing signature. And I'm thinking, oh, this better be not what I'm thinking this is. So I run down and I, you know, part all the kids, and there is my sister Monica writing. elder sister. Oh, yeah, you got it in one, Sarah. I absolutely was. School prefect is what my husband still calls me.
No more damning a description, really.
No, it is terrible, isn't it, to be called a school prefect? But I certainly was. And because we moved around a lot and our parents really just entrusted us to just get on with things and do things largely without them being around, I fell into that role of being both an older sibling, an older sister, and a parent in a way. So that probably annoyed my sister Monica even more than, oh my God, you're only 1 or 2 years older than me, and you're telling me what to do, and, you know, getting me, dobbing me into our parents or whatever it was. So I definitely played that role.
Cricket is one thing, Indira, but how did Highland dancing become a pastime?
I have no idea. It must have looked odd. These two little Indian girls, particularly my younger sisters, because they were champion dancers. I was a bit heavy-footed, and it really wasn't anything I excelled at. But three Indian girls in Tasmania, Launceston in the 1970s, wearing kilts and bonnets and doing Highland dancing. Like, what? Where? How did this happen? But no one ever came up to us and thought that it was an unusual sign to see little Indian girls, excelling. And not just dancing, but meddling. You know, we would stand on the podium and there'd be medals. Our tunics.
Well, it's a big thing in Tassie. Yeah, it certainly was.
It is, actually. I mean, look, the climate does tend to, you know, sort of take to it in a way, because you do wear lots of layers of wool and stockings and waistcoats and hats and things. But yes, it's a big pastime in Tasmania, and my two sisters both were excellent Highland dancers.
As you say, Dira, they are some elaborate costumes that Highland dancers wear. How did you stuff up Monica's costume one important event day?
So my role, because I was so hopeless, was just to look after wardrobe and just carry all the bags. And there's so many.
Your experience of participating in it. But what then happened when you were doing a physio during the time as a college traveller?
Yeah, so you're talking about it. You're in the best shape of your life, but everything hurts. Like going upstairs, it's terrible. Everything is sore, bruises everywhere. And so my foot has been sore in some of the wrestling matches and some of our training. And I really think about it. And then I was actually in a physiotherapy business at the time. So we were doing an assessment of the foot, and one of the instructors came over and, just grabbed one of the bones of my foot. It kind of looked a little bit bigger than the other one. I don't think much of it about it. He grabbed it, and I just about shot off the bed, because there is not an address where I can get my foot. And he realized it, and they sort of speak to that kind of last thing. Yeah, frankly, I have no idea. Like, I think it's just because everything else hurts. Like, we do actually know that pain in another area can inhibit pain. Pain can inhibit pain. So it could have been that. But I think also just because you expect to hurt. And I had no reason to expect that my foot was broken. So I just kept going. But I have a picture of that. You kept going. You have a different experience with pain and part of my foot. Part of, like, no, this is not good to have in the medical training. sensitive about that area where I have this partial missing hair. I'm like, oh no, like it's too bad for me. I tried it again and I think it didn't work. I thought, okay, maybe I'll just try like normal cues, because I know last week I literally was able to like go for a 30-minute run and I was totally fine. So I put on my normal cues, went for a run. I'm here, wow, yeah, I'm looking good, I'm feeling good, I'm here, still feeling good.
Red was communication. So beautiful.
Thank you. feel what we feel in our back. And I'm really interested in the field of back stiffness, of that constant slow moving dream that people have. And for this one, if you think about it, you know, joy, it often, you know, makes noises, doesn't it? It cracks, it grinds, it grumbles. And so I'm just really interested to see how to thank you. that of having anyone to be able to get a treatment. What attitudes do you recommend that people bring to their experience of pain? An attitude of openness and of curiosity to understand the complex processes that are going on. I think generally as humans, it's really hard for us to think beyond the idea of cause and effect. This happened, therefore I am one thing. One cause and it's one outcome. And it really, I think, being open to learn the fact that for every single person, including me, all of our experiences are complex and complicated, are ultimately influenced by numerous different things. And that resonates deeply in someone's gut. When that, I do think that that's what is occurring, that can be really helpful because it also can then help make it sense why we're starting to look into other areas. Small changes can we make here that actually might help? And when all of those things build up together, it's like the building in the back, but for good. There's that tipping point where things start to get better. Have you seen that in patients with people you work with? Yeah, we have. So we've done some studies with people with osteoarthritis, and some of the changes that we've seen with that have really been remarkable. So you're seeing people that haven't walked, haven't moved much, are in a lot of pain, get stiffness, get some swelling, and you're seeing the stop in engaging in life. And we see through slow but sure increases in movement, discussions, education, and conversations about what pain is and what we think contributes to things in osteoarthritis actually have beautiful outcomes where, you know, it's walking an hour a day, and what happens to you when you do feel other pain through running or other activity? How do you yourself take a handle on it? Yeah, so I guess what I do is I've been honest, my mind immediately goes to structural causes. It says, oh, have I done this? Have I done that? And then I start to do that for a bit, and then I stop myself and I remember, okay, and sort of take stock of where things are at and say, okay, I must be that person that you look at that, oh man, that crazy person is talking to herself while she's running. And I'm really just saying, okay, sorry, yep, you're doing good. And it helps me. So what kind of stuff can also work on and active distress and will have a physical impact? Yeah, and I think everyone finds their unique situation that can help them. For some people, it might be, back before they do an activity where they're just sitting in their body and relaxing into it.
They're wonderful. They have personalities. They have desires. They were
first, by the way, I let this chicken work with me in my study where I was writing the book. And they would purge sometimes on my shoulder, and they would walk to be kind to us because my wife objected because we cannot, or at least very difficult, to house train a chicken. I'm sure that our people are smart enough to know.
Looks like Lord Smith and the label done.
Part of the reason, first of all, the cat in that book, which I finally published, there's a picture, it's my favorite picture, our cat. And one of the cats, we have many, one of the cats and the big rabbit slept together at night. And the cat would literally put his arms around the rabbit and they would do that. I couldn't believe it, so I did a picture of this. And it was really true, they got on so well. Now, and part of the reason they got on so well with the dog is the dog grew up with them, so he never, ever chased cats. I mean, for him, cats were like dogs. They were family members, and the cats understood that. But cats being cats, one of them decided, really hurt my feelings. One of them decided he wanted to move next door, and he did.
Maybe he did some peace and quiet that. Maybe he needed a break from all those other animals.
Yeah. You know, I had thought of that. You're probably excited. But he suddenly started jumping up on the chest of the man they thought was a really cool kid, not like cat. And this man was thrown out. And this went on to tweet, funny the man said, I give up. He's mine. And then he stayed there for years. And then one day he decided he wanted to move somewhere else. I wonder, I haven't heard this from other people who live with cats, but I wonder if that's common, because it seems to me that cats are slightly more, and they can be very attached to it, of course, but they also seem to me to be more attached to places. Dogs don't care where they are as long as they're with you, but cats kind of like to know, this is home, this is where I live, this is, I know it well.
What about that duck giant rabbit? What ended up happening with him?
Well, we used to work, but we realized that we lived on a public beach, and he could not understand why he could only go out at night. So he started hopping around on the beach during the day, and he would hop back home. But I realized that was a dangerous situation, because dogs didn't understand who he was. And he was chased a number of times, and I was terrified that one day he would get hurt by a dog. So we had some friends who lived way up north, and they fell in love with the rabbit. They said, look, let us have the rabbit. He's totally safe here. So we did. We drove up there. We gave him the rabbit, and the rabbit was in heaven because he lived right at the edge of a huge forest. And it was a guest house. People would come and stay there. And the rabbit would greet them. He would sit on the deck and he would wait for people, then he'd hop over. And every night he would go off into the forest. So during the day, he lived there on the porch. And at night he would go into the forest. And they said one night he did not come back. And they suspect that he found another rabbit. And decided to make his life as a wild rabbit through the forest.
I mean, that's the optimistic understanding of the end of that rabbit, and I very much hope that it was the case. But, you know, that sort of points to the theme, I suppose, of this new book of yours, Jeff, is that once we enter into living with an animal, there's only two possible endpoints, aren't there? Either we die first or that animal dies first. I mean, heartbreak is built into our relationship with pets.
Absolutely. And you know, it's almost as you say that, as you were saying, and I was thinking about Popple Popple, as we call them. We call them Popple Popple. But it was scary to think that when they go off on their own like that, they might not come back. And of course, I do believe that something must have happened, because he had a lovely life with these people, and then he did not come back. And it's very difficult to face that all of these animals are going to die before we die. But we had pet rats for our two boys growing up, and they adored these rats, and I knew they were all So it was a tremendous blow to the children when these animals would die. They took it very seriously. And when they were very young and they still didn't really know what the concept of death was, they couldn't quite understand why are they no longer here. And in a sense, that's true of even adults. You know, why aren't you here? I sometimes think about my father. I would love to tell you things that I'd love to tell you.
Is that one of the benefits, in a way, for children in particular, perhaps, to have a pet? It is an introduction to mortality. It is an introduction into the reality that living beings die, and we do all die. Is that part of this sort of deep lesson that we get from animals?
Well, thank you, Sarah. That's a really interesting idea. I had not myself thought of it. So, had I talked to you before? That's a very good point. Yes, I think you're absolutely right. I mean, you can't spare people from this. And there is something wonderful about children loving another creature and then losing that creature, because they're not indifferent when the animal goes. They feel it profoundly. And that's important because that teaches them about grief and mourning and kind of, if you like, almost the upside of that, how it releases feelings in them that they might not otherwise have access to. And there are many adults who cannot grieve and cannot mourn. And I would wager that they did not have those early experiences as a child, which loosened up those emotions inside of them.
What about your own experience, Jeff? Or what was your first experience with the death of a pet?
I can remember that I was very, very attached to a cat. And this cat was taken very early from its mother, so it thought of me as the mother, and it would sleep with me at night. And by the way, one of the great pleasures of life is sleeping with a cat. They're amazing companions at night. You know, they stretch their little bodies out, they begin to purr, and that sense that they trust you to be next to them at night, not harm them. And it's a wonderful feeling. But this cat was sucking on my pajamas, and my mother didn't like that. She had this absurd notion of the cat would suffocate me, silly urban myth. So without telling me, she took this beloved cat of mine away and left it in the mountains. And I didn't know that at the time, of course, and was totally distraught. And a week later, the cat came back.
Well, it made its way back from the mountains.
It made its way back from the mountains. It must have been 10 miles, I would think. And it came back, and I cannot tell you how elated I was. And then a month later, quote, it disappeared again. That cat did not disappear. My mother, God help her, did it again. And I found out many years later when my mother and father were having a big argument. And my father said, you're just a cruel person. Look what you did to Jeffy's cat. And I was horrified to hear that.
God, did you end up forgiving her for that kid?
No. No. I mean, she loved me very much, but she did have a cruel streak. And that is one of the only instances I can think of. And I never got it. She died at 97. I mean, karma. She came from Los Angeles to New Zealand to be with us. And she had dementia, and she was with us for 10 years there. So from about 87 to 97, she had severe dementia. And the only pleasure she got was from our dog. I would take my dog over there, and her eyes would light, and she would pat him. And every time she pat him, I think, I wish I could tell you what you did to my cat.
I mean, I think it's changing now, but I still think there's a tendency when a child is grieving over a pet that either has been taken away deliberately or more commonly, you know, just died a natural death. Sometimes adults around that child try to discount it or say, look, it doesn't matter, or you'll get over it, or let's get another dog or another turtle. And how do you think that we should respond to children who are grieving a loss of a pet?
Terrible of you to do that, and you're absolutely right. That was my experience. Fortunately, not with my father, who was very loving towards animals. Like I remember when I had a hamster who was managing I went this week leaving a note to my father, please tear down the wall. And yes, he came home with my mother from watching a movie, and he tore down the wall and rescued my hamster. So I was very grateful for that. So he never told me, just get over it. But many, many children were told that. I saw that in the neighborhood where we live. And I took it upon myself to tell them, no, that's not true. You know, it was a wonderful animal, and of course you're going to feel bad. I always felt that way. But society definitely has changed now. I think it would be the rare parent who would say, oh, stop it. It's just a rabbit. It's just a lizard. It's just a dog. It's just a cat. They wouldn't say that anymore. And I think you should never tell that to anyone, no matter how long or how deeply they grieve, that that really is their business, that it's your business to support them. And if you can, at least be quiet. Do not belittle their feelings.
Later on, if you were a graduate student in India, what was the Indian attitude towards dogs when you were living there?
Well, that's interesting because in spite of the fact that a dog makes a very important entrance into Indian mythology, in spite of that, Indians, at least when I was there, had a very bad attitude. And they would throw stones at them. They were called pariah dogs. But they really were village dogs. They did not belong to anyone, and they did not look happy. And I think the reason is that every one of those dogs wanted to be part of a family. They wanted to belong, and they couldn't, so they managed on their own. And then I had this very strange experience with a puppy. I was a graduate student at Stanford, and one day I was in a house, and I heard down below a terrible sound. There was a car breaking and a dog screaming, and I ran down, and a mother dog and her puppy were there, and the mother was killed, and the little puppy couldn't have been more than 3 or 4 weeks old, so really not ready to leave his mother. And I took the puppy, and despite what everyone says, it won't live, you can't take it, put it down, I refused, and I kept it. And this puppy was, as you can imagine, deeply attached to me. Well, the time came for me to go back to the United States, and there was no way that they would allow me to bring a dog from India into America. So I had some friends who lived way off in the country, and they said, we'll take the dog, we promise you. It's called Puppy, we promise you Puppy will have a great life. And I said, okay. But it was very sad. It was heartbreaking. Because this dog is literally never left my side. You know, he slept with me, and he was constantly my presence. I was father, everything to him, friends. And he was only by then, you know, more than 6 months old. And the only time I ever left him was when I went to my lessons at the university. I had a very old-fashioned professor of Sanskrit. I was studying Sanskrit then, and he was a very orthodox Brahmin. And he was not supposed to teach people like me. He was called Vlekas, foreigners. And to study Sanskrit was just unheard of for these very orthodox. But he liked me very much. Now, he only spoke his own language, which was from South India, Tamil, which I didn't know. And he didn't speak a word of English, so we communicated in Sanskrit. And people were fascinated by this. Whenever we would go anywhere and people would hear him speaking Sanskrit, they would
Because is a very ancient holy language, isn't it? It's not
that's
very
right.
Spoken language in
no,
India.
No,
it's
no,
the
not at all.
Language of religion.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, it'd be like speaking ancient Greek, you know. In any event, he was a wonderful man, but he had the usual prejudices, and that is the dog will kill the unclean animal. And the day after I left my dog, and I was being very sad, and I was in his office, he would only teach me at 6 in the morning, so that nobody would see us. So there I was at 6 in the morning, and I told him in Sanskrit what had happened, and he, you know, he kind of understood, but he didn't understand. At that moment, there was a knock on the door, and I thought he looked petrified because nobody was supposed to know he was doing this. It would ruin his reputation. And this knock on the door petrified him. I opened the door, and who came in? You can guess. It was Puppy. And we have no clue to this day
same time, it's very eloquent. He made up the Sanskrit verse. I was astonished that we had written down, but the meaning was, you and this animal are tied. You must never leave him again. He was yours in a former life. And I think what he believed is that that was my wife in a former life. He first believed in the incarnation. I then thought, well, he's right. You know, I cannot do this. If this animal, under mysterious circumstances, managed to find the universe where he had never been, there is some bond between us. And I was, what can I do? Can I live for the rest of my life in India? How do I manage this? And I remember very clearly thinking about this. A little puppy was on my lap and was looking up in my face. And he suddenly looked at me and gave a deep sigh. Like a and died. It was such, I'm not a religious person, I'm not a spiritual person, but there was something very, very strange about that.
What is the story in the Indian epic, the Mahabharata, about a stray dog?
Well, the Mahabharata is the greatest Indian epic, and it's a huge book. It would be, in translation, of like 20 volumes. Very simple sense, it's very lovely looking. And with this pundit one day, I said, I'd like to read something inspiring, and he said, I have the right thing for you, and it was a dog story. What it is, the great king Ishida is moving north, which in mythological terms means he's coming to the end of his life. He's going to go to the Himalayas, and that's where he'll ascend into heaven. And he went with his entire court, his younger brothers, all the family are moving north, and he was accompanied by a little dog. And this is very unusual in India, and people wanted to stop it, and he said, no, no, this dog has been a faithful companion, let him come with me. So the dog went, and eventually everybody died. So very long, oh, I don't know, maybe a 50-page poem went into the story of Mahabharata, as all of these people slowly died. The reason having to do with their karma, what they did wrong, and so on. And in the end, it's just the king by himself. He reaches the Himalayas, and he's at the peak of a mountain, and the chariot from heaven comes down to get him, and they say, Mount, blessed king, you have been a wonderful king, your reward is waiting for you. He turns to the dog, he says, come on, we're going, and the charioteer says, sorry, no dog is allowed in heaven. So he says, if this dog will not go to heaven, neither will I. And at that moment, the dog reveals himself to be the Lord of Justice. That was the right story to you. Ancient. So if dogs are 50,000 years old, then they co-evolved with us. And that means that would explain why there's this intense bond that we are actually, you could even say we're a single species. We evolved to be together. Because the astonishing thing to me is that the only instance in nature of two species forming an intense bond is dogs and humans.
Speaking close to relationship that stretches back so many thousands of years, what's the right word to describe it? I mean, is it one of reciprocal loyalty, that protection and subservience, or is it love? How do you describe it?
Well, I think you raised an interesting question. What is it? Yes, it is definitely love, but it encompasses more than love, although, in a way, nothing is greater than love. But what I find so strange is that this love is more intense than anything else we have. The ambivalence, I mean, of course, I adore my wife, and if you knew her, you would understand why.
But where this is going, then?
There are moments when we look at one another and wonder, you know, what are we about? We don't wonder what we're doing together. But most couples do. Why are they saying that? What's the matter? Why can't they understand? But with a dog, that's never the case. They never feel the slightest ambivalence. They do towards other dogs, of course, other animals. But towards us, once they love you, they don't care what happens to you. You're sick. You're old, you've lost your money, you're homeless, they adore you in the same way. And that never changes. It doesn't even change over time. I mean, you go way out of the apartment, you put out your keys, you come back 2 minutes later, and the dog, you're back. Thank you. They don't want you to be away from them for 1 minute. There's no other relationship like that. We don't have that relationship with any other human. And dogs probably love us more than they love themselves.
Podcast. You're listening to Conversations with Eric Moxie. Any more conversations any time on the ABC listener app. Or go to abc.net.au/conversations.
Seth, one of the peculiar qualities of our species is that we know about death. We know, even if we don't want to think about it, we know that 100% it can guarantee to happen. Is there any indication that dogs have that awareness? Are they aware when death is coming for them or for another animal?
I believe they do. You know, you can't say that there's definite evidence, but I believe that animals do understand death, and dogs in particular tend to. Cats probably act like they believe it. You know, you're looking at the cat is getting older and older, and you live near the country, and one day the cat's gone. They've gone off to die by themselves. Why they would do that, I don't know. It's almost as if they're saying, look, I began as a solitary species, I would end that way.
Your dog has loved you.
No, I don't. I love them. Often as much as I love a very hard to take. They live on average longer than dogs, so you live with them longer. And I've had, up until now, I've had cats my entire life. So they've been a very, very important part of my life.
What's different in terms of the cat's relationship with the wellness?
The cat really is a much more wild animal than a dog. So I don't believe you can really talk about total domestication for cats. I don't think we domesticated dogs. And it might have been something we did in combination with them, but it's something we did together. But with cats chose to live with us. And they can just as easily choose not to live with us. Remember that cats descend from the African wild cat, which is a solitary species. Does not mingle with other cats except to mate, and when they're very young. They don't have friends, they don't do friendships. So it's really quite extraordinary that they do become friends with us and allow us to share their lives. But it's never entirely, they're not subservient. It's rare that a cat looks to you as, oh, you're the boss here.
They tolerate us.
They do, they tolerate us. It's an honor for you. Exactly the way a wild cat would behave. When I'm beginning now for the first time ever to think about what is wrong with our having domestic animals. I mean, obviously when it comes to pigs and goats and cows and sheep and ducks and chickens and so on and rabbits on a farm, you know what's wrong with it. They're going to be killed. But I would say that's definitely not true for dogs and cats. It's not pure exploitation. But it is to some extent. They don't really have, they're not free to choose. Well, I mean, the lovely thing about having a cat, by the way, as opposed to having a dog, especially in Australia, is the cats are free to roam. So if you have a cat who has a cat door, or the great invention of humanity, and they go out whenever they want, they come back when they want, I like that.
I like it too. I just know that my native birds and lizards are not happy about it.
That's exactly right. And that's what happened to us in New Zealand. Our neighbors were enraged that we had six cats. And I understand because they were hunted. And I tried to talk to the cats and it was like, you know, I'm giving you the middle finger. I'm a cat. That's what I do.
Tell me the story just about Mama's last hug that she wrote.
Yeah, that's an extraordinary story. This is Franz de Waal, who has written a new book called Mama's Last Hug, and it's about animal emotions. And by the way, that's becoming a very popular topic now for scientists, which it never was. When I wrote When Elephants Weep, I mean, about 25, 26, 27 years ago, I was laughed at. Oh, that's pure anthropomorphism. You're just imagining this. You don't know anything about what these animals feel. You can't prove scientifically they feel anything at all. And that was the attitude. But that changed a lot. And Franz de Waal is considered one of the leading researchers in this field. And a very, very good book, Mama's Last Hug. Because they called it that, an old chimpanzee who was the matriarch of a colony of chimps in a zoo in Holland, the Netherlands. And her name was Mama. She was 59 years old. It was extraordinarily old. And she was dying. And a researcher, an old man, I wouldn't call that old anymore, but that's what other people would call it, decided he wanted to get to see her for years and years and years. And he heard she was dying and he wanted to come and say goodbye. So he came there. And he was a very distinguished professor of biology who had known her when she was very young and spent time with her, but hadn't seen her for something like 40 years. And he arrived and he started to open the door to her cage, and the researcher said, don't do that. Chimps are about 5 times stronger than any male human, and nobody in their right mind would ever walk into a cage with a large chimpanzee. But he did. And she'd been very depressed. She just lay in her nest. She was sister. She is Aelin's too. You know, these animals do not belong to you, obviously. And to say that you're going to study their emotions in the zoo is ignorant.
Yes, I want to ask you about your own background, a little bit more about your story. Tell me about your religious background. What tradition would you raise in?
Well, I'm Jewish, but my parents, I was born in 1941, and my parents, my father, in 1945, became enamored of an English journalist by the name of Paul Brunton, who was living in India, in Mysore, with the Maharaja of Mysore, and he had written a book called A Search in Secret India, in which he introduced Ramana Maharshi, who was still, in my opinion, one of the few Indian gurus who seemed genuine. And he wrote about him, and that book that is, gosh, 1938, and it became a huge bestseller. Someone said, Wong used this in his book, his final novel, when he traveled India to be there. And so my father went to India to meet Paul Brunton, and they got on very well. My father was a wealthy jeweler, and the gurus like wealthy people. And Paul Brunton became a part of our life. So when he left India, he often lived with us. He lived with us in South of France. He lived with us in Los Angeles. He lived with us in Portugal and lots of parts of the world. Wherever we were, Brunton would come and stay with us. And he decided that I was going to be his successor. So he taught me what we now call mindfulness, meditation, and I was completely taken in with it. I completely believed it, and believed that I was special, and that I was to be this guru figure.
And your parents encouraged you?
Yeah, very much so, yeah. He was not, I would call him a total fraud. He's just a minor fraud. He told me, for example, he could never drive a car, and I said, well, TB, when we were young, my sister and I would say, TB, we call it TB, Paul Brunton, why don't you drive a car? He said, well, you see, he's always mysterious. He said, this funny little smile. He said, I'm Venus, there are no cars. I said, what? You mean you're from Venus? And we'll say no more. You know, when you're a little kid, you know, oh my God, that's so fascinating.
And was he being serious though, Jeff? Was he just having fun with you as a little kid, or was he actually suggesting
No, he really, I don't know if he really believed it, but he just, I mean, talked that way to my parents too. For example, he called himself Dr. Brunton. And I once said, well, where did you get your PhD? He said, from the Astro University. And could I go in and say, one day I will take you there, Jeff, when you can meditate deeply enough, then you'll be able to fly to other planets. So he believed all this nonsense, or he didn't, I don't know, it's very hard to say.
As a young child, as a teenager, if this was the world your parents inhabited, it would have been a natural that you believed it too. That was your understanding of things.
Well, is it natural, though? This is an interesting, is it natural to believe this? My children, for example, both of them were much, much younger, were very skeptical of anything. So I had a colleague in Auckland who believed in crop circles. And when Ilan must have been 12 and Manu was 7, he insisted we come and watch this movie of the proof that crop circles were made by aliens. And those two boys, 7 and 12, were howling with laughter at how naive he was. Are you kidding me? They would say, have you ever seen those questions that come back? You pay them $50 and they'll make a crop circle for you. They were totally skeptical.
Were you skeptical of TV?
No, that's the thing. I was like, you know, I sometimes think in many ways I was not socially advanced. And I think it's because of this, because of my parents raising me with this mumbo jumbo, which was fun, you know, when you're young, it was entertaining. I went to India, we meet all these strange people, the man who played Tarzan into our house, he was also interested in Paul Brunton, and it was a kind of magic world. But until I was about, even when I got to Harvard as an undergraduate, I Only very gradually did I give it up. I must have been about 22 or 23 years old, which is pretty late to come into rational thinking, don't you?
Tell me about what this guru, what TV preached about the end of the world and how that affected
you. Well, yes, yes. So that had a tremendous effect on us. He believed that there was going to be a third world war, which, you know, not entirely fake in those days at that time because of the Cuban Missile Crisis and so on. So he convinced my parents, and my father in particular, who had been a successful gem merchant, he said, you've got to wind everything up and you have to move to South America. Why South America? Because he said, I've done research. And when the bomb is dropped, that's going to be the safest place. So we moved to Uruguay, and we waited for TV to come, and he didn't come. And we stayed there. We were there for 2 years. I was 18, so, you know, old enough to know better.
Were you living with other adherents, or just your family?
No, they all scattered. So there were people living in Chile. There were people living in Peru, in Brazil, and we were in Uruguay, and in Argentina. So we did meet a number of disciples of a different guru in Argentina, became very close to them. And then I started to feel, I got antsy. I said, look, I'm 18 years old, I can't live the rest of my life here in Uruguay. I want to be educated, I want to go to an American university. And they warned me, no, you must think the world's going to end. And I said, well, I'll take my chances. And so I did. I applied and I went to Harvard.
That must have been quite a transition from Uruguay to Harvard.
Yes, it was a huge transition. And, I mean, it's a miracle that I got it. Mind you, in those days, we're talking 1961, it was a lot easier to get into Harvard than it is today. But it was a mistake because I did dance. And that was a terrible error.
Why?
Well, because I was in it for the wrong reasons. I was in it for spiritual reasons. And by the time I got my BA, and then eventually, you know, what do you do with a BA in Sanskrit? You can only teach it, so you have to get a PhD. So I eventually got a PhD from Harvard Sanskrit, and suddenly woke up one day, as it were, in Toronto, teaching Sanskrit, saying, what am I doing teaching Sanskrit? This is not me. This is not what I want to do.
Had you fallen out of the belief in school? You had separated yourself. You weren't a follower anymore.
Yeah, I was becoming skeptical, and we had one last meeting in Portugal. And he said to me, Jeffrey, I'm very deeply disturbed. It looks like you're leaving the path. And I said, yes, it does look that way. And he said, well, I was hoping you would carry on my work. Is there anything that would bring you back? And I said, no, I really don't think so. I've been exposed to all these books, and, you know, I've studied Sanskrit now. I realize it's not what you told me, and so on. And he said, well, we were sitting around the dinner table. I don't know, there's been 6, 7, 8 of us, and there's a big, large oak dining room table. And he said, suppose I would arrange this table and make it dance in the air. Would that convince you? And I thought, if you make this table jump into the air and dance around, that would be something I would reconsider. And so he made us all close our eyes, and then he placed his hands on the table. Everybody had to put their hand on the table, close their eyes, and then he started chanting what he claimed was Sanskrit, but which I knew was not. And then it's very important to keep your eyes closed. So of course I opened my eyes. And what I saw was this tiny little man who was under 5 feet tall, very, very small. He took his little hand and he started pushing the table. And he said, I feel it. The spirits have come. The table is moving. And at that moment, that I will forever regret it, I said, I'm not surprised the table is moving because you're shaking it with your teeny little hand.
Why do you regret saying that? This seems a perfectly reasonable thing to say.
Of course, but imagine what would he have done? I mean, if I had only shut up, I would have seen, I suppose he would have said, no, the spirits, they don't like the atmosphere today or something. But I would have been curious to know that everybody was very embarrassed. And my father's
hypothesis is that the reward didn't eventuate, and did they become skeptical?
Well, they got a little bit skeptical when he didn't show up. So we were waiting for him in South America, and we never knew where he went. And so one day, I was giving a talk in, of all places, Auckland, New Zealand, and I mentioned his name, and somebody said, oh, yeah, no, yeah, he lives down the street from the other one. It turned out that TV went to New Zealand. So we never knew. Then moved to Switzerland, and he died in Switzerland. I think he was about 82. But not, and after that, I then told my father that I wanted to write about this, and I wrote a book called My Father's Guru, A Journey Through Spirituality and Disillusion. Mm-hmm. And I think that that also disillusioned my parents to some extent, because I mean, it was a friendly book, but it was definitely an attempt to expose the guru and other gurus. It was an anti-cult book, and the people who would follow them would never talk to my parents again.
You say that when you sort of woke up to yourself and realized you were teaching Sanskrit at a university and this wasn't you and wasn't what you wanted to be doing with your life, what did you do next?
Well, I made another mistake. I decided I wanted to become a psychoanalyst. So for the next 10 years in Toronto, I was trained as a psychoanalyst. I went through the full training, which means you have to need analysis yourself 5 times a week for 10 years, then start taking patients, and you have to be supervised. You have to go to coursework for years. It was very expensive, very elaborate. And around the middle of it, I thought, this is not for me. Once again, this is not just that good for psychoanalysis, but it was a very specific thing. It was about child sexual abuse. So we were taught that women who came to us as analysts would tell us, some of them, that they've been abused as children or adolescents, and we were not to believe them. That this was not true, that this was a form of hysteria, that these were false memories. And I was appalled when I first said that. What kind of nonsense? And why would any child make up a memory like it? It made no sense to me. And they got very upset with me for not believing this, and eventually it led to, I became an analyst. I left Toronto. I went to Berkeley, California, and was setting up a practice, and I went to London, I met Anna Freud, and became close to her, and she allowed me to look into Freud's desk, and there I found all these letters about child sexual abuse, and I started talking about it, and analysts were enraged. I was director by then of the Freud Archive, they took that away from me. A betrayal. You are the Antichrist in the Church of Psychoanalysis. It was terrible. I mean, it really was. I lost my directorship. I lost my license to practice. By then, I'd given up my full professorship at the university. And I was living with Catherine McKinnon, and she said, you know what, Alan, why don't you write about what you really love and what you really love are animals? So write a book about the emotional life of animals, and that's how I came to write for them.
That's quite a journey to get to write about animals, Deb.
I know. Really, you know, that's three totally different lives.
And which is giving you most pleasure?
Well, the animals, no doubt. And, you know, the reason, I think, is we don't totally, I mean, we don't even begin to understand them. Even, you know, living with pets, you don't really know what's going on. They, you know, why are they with us? What do they think of us? There's so much still to be uncovered.
Do you think that people can get some of the healing from animals that we often turn to medical practitioners for?
Oh, definitely. First of all, I've never been a psychiatrist who's as good as a dog. Really, I mean that. I think there's no therapy like being with a dog. Walking a dog, being with a dog in nature, sleeping with a cat, any of these things. And of course, they are interested now
Well, yeah, we had a lot of fun.
How important was
followed cricket. And we absolutely did. We were all born in South Africa. Then we moved to Zambia. And then, of course, we had all the inheritance. So cricket is very, they're very passionate about that as well. Then we moved to England, of course, where Chris started. And then came to Australia. So cricket really was the soundtrack of our lives. Early in the morning when you wake up, you hear the sound of, you know, the letter on Willow, one of the commentators' voices that we got to know, you know, from Tony Gregg to the ABC commentators. That was just what was always humming in the background in our house. And going and seeing live matches was the highlight of us.
Inspired by Tony Gregg, what game did you used to play in the backyard?
One of the things Tony Gregg used to do was his pitch report. Before every game, he would crouch on the pitch and post his pen or his speed into a crack in the pitch to give you a sense of whether it was going to be a good pitch for the bowlers or the batting stuff. And we used to just love that moment where
the drama.
I know, the drama, and the camera would go in for a close-up of the crack and then you pull out the dirt and there'd maybe be a bit of grass or dirt on it. And then what we would do during the break, we'd grab one of Mum's dead for the house keys and we'd run around the backyard. One of these keys in the backyard. I don't know why that was so fun, but that was what we did. And yeah, it was really inspired by Tony Gregg.
One glorious summer, the West Indies team came to Launceston. They come here.
No one took us. So we never got really taken many places. We just went on our own. I mean, we just walked down the road and walked into, you know, wherever we needed to go. That was just life growing up in countries we had no tickets. Yeah, we had some tickets, and but we got up in early in the morning, we prepared our kitchen basket, napkin, and our autograph book to make sure that we could, you know, try to get an autograph of one of the players. And we just headed to the cricket pitch on our own, and we were just so used to doing that. And we had to remember the tickets because they were very passionate about that. And that was also, I'm sure, quite a funny sight. These three little darky girls sitting with largely older white men in the members' stand, but very serious. You know, all our girlfriends were at, you know, shopping or watching it at the cinema or something, but we were there with our furnace and our transistors, you know, all these sort of detailed conversations and remarks about their batting performance and how the bowling was going. I don't know what they thought of us, but that particular day we were at the West Indian cricket team, which were the rock star god cricket team in the 1970s, were doing a very unusual cricket tournament in Launceston, and often, you know, the big teams didn't come to Tasmania. So we were so excited, and we couldn't wait to get a photograph. So my younger sister, Monica, while there was a break on the play, ran down to the fence line where the fielders would often stand and give the little kids their autograph to try to get one. And we sort of lost track of my other sister and we were watching the game, and then a bit later on we wondered where Monica was. And when I looked down near the fence, instead of her at the fence waiting for a cricketer, she was surrounded by this throng of kids, and I'm thinking, what's going on? And this young little kid came running out of his little scrum and said, Mum, Dad, I've got this amazing thing. Darren, I'm thinking, oh, this better be not what I think this is. So I run down, and I, you know, pass all the kids, and there is my sister Monica writing her name in an autograph book. Monica ripped it. So I yank her away and I go, what are you doing? And she says, oh, the kid came up to me because I asked him, they said, am I related to any of the West Indian players? And I sort of said, yes, I am. And they said, which one? And so I had to just come up with a name and I said, Vivian Richard.
And it's the stars, like,
yeah,
that's
one of the biggest Indian names in the world at the time. And the kid then said, well, if you're Vivian Richard, daughter, can we have your autograph? And so, you know, she's only like 6 or 7. She went, yeah, okay. So she just made up Monica Richards and just kept writing that next autograph for us. Oh my gosh, she was so naughty, and I, oh, I'm mad. And I said, I'm going to tell Mum and Dad. But, you know, I never did tell Mum and Dad about it because I thought, you know, she sort of made their day. Those little country kids, you know, they don't often meet stars. So
they're probably still being cherished in some autograph book somewhere in New York.
I'm sure. So I'm sort of letting the cat out of the bag. If you've got Monica Richards in the autograph book, it wasn't real.
But was that diplomatic of the kind of character Monica?
daring and, I mean, just naughty, incredibly naughty. She was anti-authoritarian. She never did what her parents listened to, wanted her to do. She tried to just get out of everything. You know, I ended up having to unpack the dishwasher when it was her job. If she couldn't finish her homework, one of us would have finished, you know, running whatever she needed. And she just had those terrific days and these little dimples, and she got away with it. You know, she ended up basically doing whatever she mostly wanted to do. But a lot of it was incredibly naughty. And she loved stirring people up, you know, particularly adults or older people. And so she claimed a little bit, but then she did something to either embarrass them or make them feel uncomfortable.
And what about you, Daryl? Were you the stereotypical bossy elder sister?
Oh, yeah, you got a little one, Sarah. I absolutely was. School prefect is what my husband still calls me.
No more bossing.
I know, it is terrible, isn't it, to call the school prefect. But I certainly was. And because we moved around a lot, and our parents really just entrusted us to just get on with things and do things largely without them being around, I fell into that role of being both an older sibling, an older sister, and a parent in a way. So that probably annoyed my sister mother even more. And, oh my God, you're the only one or two years older than me, and you're telling me what to do, and, you know, getting me telling me, filling me into our parents or whatever it was. So I definitely played that role. Cricket is one thing in Europe, but how did Highland dancing become a pastime? I have no idea. It must have looked odd. The two little Indian girls, particularly my young sisters, because they were fancy dancers. I was a bit heavy footed and it really wasn't anything I excelled at. But three Indian girls in Tasmania, Launceston in the 1970s, wearing kilts and bonnets and doing Highland dancing. Like, what? Where? How did this happen? But no one ever came up to us and thought that it was an unusual sign to see little Indian girls, excelling. And it's not just dancing, but meddling. You know, we would stand on the podium and they'd meddle. How
was a big singing happening?
Yeah, it certainly was. Yeah, that really looks, the climate does tend to, you know, sort of taste good in a way, because you do wear lots of layers of wool and stockings and waistcoats and hats on. But yes, it's a big pastime in Tasmania, and my two sisters both were excellent couple of girls.
As you say, they have some elaborate costumes that Thailand dancers wear.
We want to pick up management costumes in one of the event days. So my role, because I was so hopeless, was just to look after wardrobe and just carry all the bags. And there's so many costumes. Each dance had its own part and its own skirt and off associated with it. So there were just bags and bags that I had to carry. And there was a particular little bonnet that had to go with Monica's outfit for the little that she was competing in. And she was the favourite to win the gold medal in this event. It was a very, very big deal. And I was meant to borrow one from her favourite school. When we were packing up all the outfits, my mother said, "Where is that bonnet to get it that I told you to get?" And I remember I completely forgot. And I know that you get marked if you don't have the right costume. Disqualified. I was terrified now, but I said I was going to disqualify it. So I sort of lied and said, "Look, I've got it. It's all sorted. Don't worry. It's in my other bag." So they all moved into the car, and I went to the lounge room and grabbed an alternative that I thought no one would realize this is what it was. And it wasn't until we got to the competition, and I was sitting in the stand, and my sisters had come up with all the other little girls and mothers. All squat down to adjust their outfits, make sure they're absolutely picture perfect for this competition. So I raced down in that moment and I whip out this little bonnet out of my pocket and I pin it to Monica's head and she starts it out. And I'm convinced no one's going to think that it's not like a real bonnet. But immediately the judge's eyebrows shoot up and then there's some giggling that comes from the stands and I'm there going, "Oh, no," they all realise this is not a top of the uniform. So the music starts and everyone's dancing and Monica's a bit distracted by all the giggles. And as she dances more and more, the giggles start getting louder in turning into laughter. And then my mother just sort of looks up and she's been embroidering something or fixing a button on a costume and she looks down at Monica on the stage and realises
left arms, and immediately the knee stops, she pulls whatever's on her head off and looks at it for the first time and realizes it's not a bonnet, and that what I've done is I've put a doily on her head that I found on the back of the couch in the lounge, thinking it looked very similar, but obviously it didn't. And she just finds me into the grandstand and starts stomping in my direction, and I'm thinking, oh no, I mustn't hear the end of this. And yes, no one talks to me. Well, not just her, no one in the family talked to me for like a week after I pulled off that paper.
Well, from forcing, you know, Richard Signet to false bonnet, there's like a trail of criminal destruction left in your wake across the stage. That's what's clear. Another time your grandmother visited from South Africa. How did your mum prepare the house in anticipation for her arrival?
Well, it was such a special event, Sarah, because we did live away from South Africa where most of our relatives were living at the time. So when anyone came to visit, particularly our grandmother, our Aya, it was such a special event because it only happened every 5-10 years. So all the traditional food that my grandmother cooked with, that we had sort of moved away from in our more Western culture, we had to stock the fridge and freezer with. So things like pigs trotters. So there's a really famous South African pigs trotter code that my parents used to have a male pig, but we didn't grow up with them, and my grandmother loved that. So pigs trotters went into the freezer, all the different offal brains, liver, things that again that we never ate as kids. Fish roe, you know, which is a sack of fish eggs. So there are a lot of little kids then, disgusting things in the freezer, so again. So you know immediately that there's a relative from South Africa coming when you see those little things coming out. And then my mum was a practicing Hindu, and as part of her practice, there would be sort of a sarmi and basically, you know, an altar. And so that would all be clean, and all the bronze would be polished up. And yeah, it was very elaborate, the preparation, all the new sheets and towels were bought. And then I was kicked out of my room because that was also the spare room when we had coaches, and that was where I was going to sleep. So we were also excited because when she came, it was also a very rare opportunity to get all the special Indian masalas and curry powders that we never usually had, and we had to always make do in Australia. I mean, at the time we were living in Australia in the 70s in Tasmania, no one could get, we knew what coriander was. I mean, now you can get both in shops and supermarkets, but you couldn't get that back then. So when the relatives come with these spices, oh my gosh, you know, the suitcases would be unzipped on the floor, and all those amazing aromas would waft out, and we knew that we were going to be eating really well for a few weeks.
Did she make you watch her dress, watch her put on her ties?
She did. We would sit on the bed in the mornings after she came out of the shower, and we would sort of see the transformation. And what we would see is her hair was really not clear. We only had storage in the past. But after a shower, it would be long, all the way down to her waist, and she'd comb it, and she'd sort of rub off coconut oil in it. And then the really magical thing was what she just put on the sari. And this is still fascinating to me. I still can't put on the sari properly to this day, because it's one long rectangle piece of fabric that Indian women just managed to wrap around themselves and make it look so elegant and beautiful, like they're gliding on water. And our eyes, you know, showed us how to pin it and how to create the pleats and how to tie it in the right place and then throw it over her shoulder. And rub oil of olive, which was her favourite magical, mystical potion that kept her skin soft and smooth and glistening. And she'd always say, put cream on your body, children. So funny, because when I write about that in the book, a woman from India contacted me, and she said, my grandmother used to say the same thing about oil of olive. I think it's all the things around the world with that particular potion. So we were